of the black and brown demographic and others in general would find the SPLC's labeling of you as a hate group. Is there any truth to that? Are y'all a hate group?
That is absolutely untrue. The Southern Poverty Law Center calls us a hate group because we bring up the crimes that's done to blacks and Latinos, which is ridiculous. Like if you call us a hate group, then why aren't you calling the NYPD a hate group? Or the Los Angeles Police Department? I ain't killed nobody. Exactly. I ain't dragged nobody out of their car. I ain't split nobody's head open.
Facts.
I didn't rape no women, you know, on a car stop. Facts. I ain't mass incarcerating and planting drugs on people. How you gonna call us a hate group, but you ain't gonna call, listen, matter of fact, you got to call the whole United States a hate group.
At this point.
So how you gonna say that? So see, they call us a hate group because we turn around and say, the white man is the devil for the things that he's done. The word devil just means adversary. This man has been an adversary to black and brown people for the last 400 years. And it hasn't let up yet. All the crimes that have been committed.
I'm here with Ronnie Medlock.
How you doing, brother? And it says on his badge, Ronnie the Mayor. So we know who running things down here. You hear me? But we down here in a historical jazz district on 18th and Vine. And I had a couple of questions. All right, so down here at the 18th and Vine of the jazz district, like, what does this mean to you as a brother? I know you like jazz.
Well, not only jazz, it's the history of it.
Okay.
It's the history of 18th and Vine.
Yeah.
Most African Americans came out to migrate during that time from the Deep South.
Okay.
And they made their homes here. It's so much to me, the history, and to learn the history of the people and how they came and they made it what it was. They made that. When you see all of the history down here, when you see all of the jazz musicians, not only that, but just the baseball players. Because see, when you come down through here, this is made up of baseball players and jazz musicians. But it was like downtown, and it had black-owned businesses down here. It was vibrant, you know, and it was just the idea to come here. Because people would come from all, even now, people come from all over the world just to visit the Negro League Baseball, just to visit the American Jazz Museum, just to get a taste to see all of the famous artists like you see right here. People like Charlie Parker, people like Count Basie, you know, Mary Lou Williams, people behind him, Jay McShane, Bobby Watson. Well, see, these are all jazz musicians. But the thing about it was, see, baseball players wanted to be jazz musicians, and jazz musicians wanted to be baseball players. you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But it was alive.
It was a live time.
Yes, it was.
Do you miss those times?
Yes, I do.
You do?
And I say that because of my age. See, I'm 74 years old.
I understand.
So I miss that camaraderie that we had.
What do you think happened to it?
Well, a lot of it during the late 60s, it kind of failed a little bit. And now they're in the process of trying to bring it back to how it was. Mind you, it would never be how it was, but it could be a lot greater.
So when you say it failed, like, how did it fall?
Well, African Americans started moving out. They started moving out because there was a history where blacks could not even come past 27th Street. You see what I'm saying? But once they got a little bit more, they started moving out of the district. They started going different places, moving out. Because like I said, you couldn't even come down through here.
So it sounds like because we wanted to go venture and go to other places that we wasn't allowed.
Yes.
That the jazz district lost a lot of business.
A lot of business.
Because everyone moved out.
Moved out. And it kind of just, it declined.
And it declined.
But we had people who was seeing the greatness of it came together and said, let's try to restore. Let's try to bring it back again.
So who were the people that seen the greatness and wanted to bring it back together?
Well, people like, number one, at that time, Mary Emanuel Cleaver. He was one of the men. Like, you see, trying to bring it home.
Like, yes, sir. Yeah. And if I may, can I ask you another question?
Sure.
Now, if he wouldn't have moved out, do you feel like this historical event would have went anywhere, or could have been even thriving even more? If we would have never moved out.
Oh, if we never moved and just stayed.
And just stayed here.
And grew.
What do you think we would be now if we would have never moved out and just stayed?
It would be off the chain. It's on its way up there now, but it would be way off the chain.
It'd be way off the chain.
Way off the chain, baby.
And not only that, do you feel like, as far as, this is your opinion, in your opinion, do you feel like jazz music, the Negro Leagues, and everything that so-called black people like created and invented and owned,
they did.
Do you feel like we get the proper share or the notoriety for it?
My opinion.
Right.
No.
Most High of Christ.
No. Because that was in us. You know, when you talk about the blues, you have to understand, when you talk about jazz, you talk about what they went through their music.
Mm-hmm.
You talk about jazz, you're talking about baseball, what they suffered, how they endured the pain. It would never be like that again. And because you're dealing with a different generation.
And you said that word, endure the pain.
Yeah.
And that right there, what you said, is very important to me. Because I feel like, now this is me talking.
Okay.
I feel like before integration, if we would endure the pain
and just stay the course
where we was at and building up,
man,
it would be so much greater.
Right.
But we have to endure some pain, and we just can't sell out.
But see, what happened was we thought it was good on the other side. Some of them did. I thought it was a lot of great things. But if they had stayed on together, have that same camaraderie, stayed together, oh, man, look. Because people from all over the world come to see this, man.
Right.
They want to know, what is it about 18th and 9?
Yeah.
They heard it on TV. They heard it in stories. They heard it through jazz musicians. They heard it through baseball players. What made them so great? It was that inner piece.
Yeah.
That inner fighting.
Because we are special people.
Yeah.
We're the salt of the earth.
Yeah.
You understand?
Let me tell you something, man. This here, you look at this down here. This was vibrant. Man.
Yeah.
Black folks, everybody just walking together. Everybody just enjoying it. They live. We didn't have a whole lot. But what we did have, boy, talk to me.
Oh, yeah. Talk to me, and that's the thing, and that's what we teach in our organization, that if we would have endured, you understand, and we wouldn't have set
but
our
here's
eyes
the thing up. About me, excuse me, I'm sorry to interrupt. It was something behind that.
Behind what?
It was behind that downfall, too, other things, too. When they started putting drugs and stuff in our community, when they started hearing strange stuff that we, hey, man, come on. So once they started dividing us and start having us going against one another, because let me tell you, anything that divided can't stand.
So let me ask you another question, since he's made that remark or comment. Prior to us integrating and the conditions of our people then, was it worth not enduring, seeing the conditions of our people now?
Oh, our people now?
Yeah. Do you think it was worth it in the conditions and the mind states we have
now?
No,
it wasn't worth it.
It wasn't worth it?
No.
Because I agree.
I'm going to tell you why.
I agree.
One of the key things what they did, and what we did as a people, we lost who brought us over. It wasn't ourselves, but it was the Most High God. See, we used to lean toward Him. We used to get our understanding, we would pray to Him. Now we got to the point now, like I said, the master of darkness know what to do.
Right.
He didn't divide us. He wanted us to see a picture of what it was all.
I think you need to go ahead and get our flyer and get in some of these classes. You understand? Because you dropping it real heavy.
As a matter of fact, I know he's got to go, but let me introduce you guys. I know he's a very busy man.
Okay. How you doing, brother?
Good. Bob Kendrick. I'm president of Negro Leagues Baseball Museum.
Okay.
Nice to meet you.
My pleasure. Great to meet you all.
I'm going to ask you a question, Bob. Let me ask you this question.
Yes. Okay.
During the time of segregation, just give them a little bit of an idea how this down here, everybody.
He laid it down flat for us. He laid it down flat for us.
And, you know, I didn't live it. But I heard all the stories from the guys who did.
Yeah.
And particularly from those who were playing for the Kansas City Monarchs. You know, they talked about, here Buffalo Bill talked about 1885 when he said he came to Kansas City in 1938. And he said, I knew I was coming to the heart of America. But 1885 was the center of the universe. Oh, it was jumping.
It was jumping.
You know, and he would say, if you had a relative, and you came to Kansas City, and you had a relative here that you hadn't seen in a while, stand right there on the corner of 18th and Vine on a Saturday, they got to walk by then. I mean, that's what this area was like.
Right.
It was jumping.
Right.
You know, anybody who was anybody made their way to 18th and Vine.
I'm digging it.
And you have to understand that during that era of segregation, black folks could only live within about a 13 block radius. Could not live outside those 13 blocks. But I remind people, within those 13 blocks, we had everything we wanted.
Can I get a hand for that? No, that was beautiful.
Yeah.
I just want to get a brother a hand for that, just for that history, because we had everything we needed before we decided to go elsewhere. That was the point that we was making, going elsewhere and like integration. Go say that quote again.
Yeah, no.
No, that quote that you said about the universe. Can you say that again?
Oh, yeah, no. As Buck would say, he knew he was coming to the heart of America, but 18th and Vine was the center of the universe.
Now, we don't have quotes like that in our neighborhoods anymore.
No,
right.
We need that back
we
again.
We need that back.
We need that back again. And so I'm part of a story that really celebrates not only the history of black baseball, but what black baseball did for our communities. So wherever you had successful black baseball, you typically had thriving black economies. And so our story is bittersweet.
Mm-hmm.
So Jackie Robinson's breaking of the color barrier was good morally, and it was good socially, but it was devastating economically.
Mm.
We lost a lot. Because what segregation did, segregation forced us to have our own. It forced ownership. And we supported those segregated, mandated black owners.
Can I ask you a quick question?
Yes, sir.
Do you see anything wrong with that?
There was nothing wrong with that. There was nothing wrong with that. Now, the idea behind segregation itself made no sense. But what segregation ultimately created was a much more unified community within the African American community. But again, as we aspired to kind of have what the others had. You know, it's a much far more sociological story than my own feeble country boy mind can even begin to comprehend.
You're fine. Because from my eyes, and I'm younger than, you know, you both, but from my eyes, I can realize it was more bitter than it was ever sweet. And it's in fact, in my eyes, it's being like, you know, younger than you are, the conditions of our people now, and me never getting to witness any of this history that you're talking about.
Seen that.
Y'all kind of making me jealous,
that's
man.
That's what I'm saying.
It was beautiful, but, you know, baby.
What I'm saying is, though, I don't think it was ever sweet. I think I see more bitterness than I do sweetness.
Yes.
In my, you know, just from my eyes.
You know, yeah.
And history. I mean, history teaches us that it was more bitter than it was sweet.
I don't think that the African American community realized what we were losing when we lost the Negro Leagues. Yeah.
We lost everything.
We lost a lot. We lost a lot. Now,
but I can't really blame the Negro Leagues.
No.
Like more so the problem was integration.
And see, Jackie's breaking of the color barrier, in essence, spawned integration in a much larger capacity.
When you say his breaking of the color barrier,
in Major League Baseball.
So just in baseball?
And this speaks of how big baseball was. You see, baseball was the pastime. You know, I remind my younger visitors, the NBA and the NFL, they were seen as collegiate sports. Nobody really was paying them any attention. We once loved baseball.
Yeah.
It was our sport. And so it was indeed our national pastime, even though we had to create our own league. And so when he leaves the Negro Leagues to go break the color barrier in Major League Baseball, that is really the first kind of salvo in terms of sparking integration in a much broader capacity. And so this was good, like I said, it was good morally, and it was good socially. It moved us in ways socially we never dreamt of. See, but the point that you're making is, we ask for integration. We wanted equality. And yeah, the two are not the same.
Yeah.
And we're still striving for equality.
So, like you said, he broke the integration or the color barrier in a sense to where we can go drink on water fountains, we can go inside their businesses.
That we couldn't do.
Couldn't do, which means to me, just give them all our money.
Yeah, bro. In some ways, that's exactly what it was.
That's pretty much all it is. It's us giving them all our money, but yet we never reap the benefit of being an equal American citizen.
And that's the quest. That's
the quest that we're on to this day. So, was it still worth integrating, knowing we didn't reap any of the benefits that we thought we would reap?
Well, you know, it's something to ponder. It really is. You know, and
Bobby,
I think it serves as a reminder.
Could I say something, Bobby, too? As I was saying to these great young brothers here, along with that, there was a devastation of communities. By devastation of communities, was Bobby having to get more. They use certain tactics to stop us. You see what I'm saying? The infiltration of drugs and all of that. Because we was looking at the pie, but we didn't see what was up under the crust. You see what I'm saying? We was looking for that.
You know, and that's why I say it's a sociological kind of thing.
Even with that, with the drugs and everything that came, was all after integrating.
Yes.
So all the crime, all the drugs, games. All the, like you said, the gangs.
Those didn't originate.
We had more unity,
and
we had more love. You know, kids would go outside and play, and run around the streets.
We never had to worry about a thing.
Now, here in 2023, you got kids rapping about smoking ops and weed.
Right.
I mean, we can cut that out. Lock it. You got kids running around talking about murdering each other at an alarming rate, and they benefit off that as well, off the hip-hop music, off the jazz, the Negro Leagues, thanks for the dialogue. And what's the brother's name again?
I'm Bob Kendrick. I'm the president of the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum.
We appreciate you taking the time to talk to us.
I appreciate you coming to see us. Absolutely, guys.
You too.
Have a good one.
In this one room, no glass on the windows, drafty as hell. I mean, it's drafty like I can't even explain. And all you got to look forward to is the plantation right outside the window. I mean, you talk about hell. These plantations was no different than being incarcerated and being in a cell. All you want to do is get out the cell and get out in the yard just to start your day in whatever so way you would want, because this right here is amazing to even have to go through this. And after a while, the mindset, and according to the tour guide, you go out the house and a random white man can come up to you anytime he felt like and just start questioning you. And it could happen anytime, and they used it as a tool of surveillance. I mean, we could go all into it, man. It's this. If you don't do this, then
let nobody tell you crack. You know why? Because I never saw you before. But you a black man like me.
My whole life was trying to find something to follow. Had loyalty, every man tried to borrow. Felt pain and a lot of sorrow. Got betrayed, sold packs. I didn't even have my heart broke. Living confused, about to lose hope. Cops got me on the side of the road like a sideshow. Need an antidote before I croak. Now I'm setting fire to rhythm man blues, call this guitar smoke. Rebel with no cause, trying to find direction. The world got me vexed. Picked up a bad liquor habit that's hereditary from oppression. Felt like my life was on fire, trying to find an exit. Now look, 10 G's plus a good record. Sometimes a follower is a soldier, trying to find a good shepherd. Plus when you in hell, how do you excel? Wisdom, the breath of life, I believe in fairy tale. Listen well to what I tell. No calling can cause pain. something that a rebel knows very well. Can't you tell I was sent from the Lord?